Yeah, of course, they couldn't believe that I was hitchhiking in Afghanistan, but then they were still, happy to give me a ride. I just continued further up north, where I was actually detained and arrested under suspicion of being a terrorist because I looked like
what?
By who?
And I, you know, like once you go in a world everywhere, actually with a positive feeling, I believe that positive things will happen to
they
you.
Gave me, you know, after interrogation, they gave me candies, they gave me some traditional Afghan coat as a present, and you know,
wow.
It was very nice actually. So, you know, he started blackmailing me that I could get in, you know, I could get in prison for like 10 years or something, you know, if I don't collaborate
Shit.
And blah 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 stuff. So, you know, like in this kind of situation, you know, I don't know what to do. It's not so difficult finding a job in China as long as your English is good and your self-esteem is positive. I think having self-esteem is more important than having a good English or something. You know? You need to know how to advertise yourself to present them that you're good and stuff. And, you know.
Hi folks, it's Eric from Belgrade Beat, and I'm happy to present to you the longest interview we've done to date. A guy who has traveled everywhere on land, from here to China, from Serbia to China, including hitchhiking through Afghanistan, Mr. Nenad Stojanovich. This is a great interview, so just watch it and feel the possibility. If you want to leave Serbia, go east, not west. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, Mr. Nenad Stojanovic. All right, so welcome to Belgrade Beat. My name is Eric Moot, and I'm sitting here today with Nenad Stojanovic, who has traveled all over the, well, maybe not all over, but around the Asian continent, hitchhiking here from Serbia. Now, I think this is a really exciting story for people who are thinking of leaving Serbia and sort of maybe going the other direction, and just to see what that sort of looks like. So, you're back in Serbia.
Yeah, I'm back.
And
finally, after a while.
After more than 3 years, right?
I don't know really how to say it. Yeah, well, I've been in Asia maybe for about 5 years, but I made a break, like... well, I was here in Serbia last time, maybe 3 years and 4 months ago.
Yeah.
So, after 3 years and 4 months, actually. 40 months. I'm back. And yeah, it's like after you come, I mean, like once you come after so much time, like, you know, it's kind of, you see the country in a different way or something. I don't know. I mean, first, what I noticed is that like people are tall. It's, you know, like I didn't know that before I left Serbia. I mean, it depends where you go. But like once you go to Asia, then like you get used to different perspective or something.
So let's go through the journey a little bit. What made you want to leave Serbia in the first place? What made you sort of decide to get out there?
Curiosity. Yeah, I'm a curious person. And... well, that's the main reason, I think. And well, besides that reason, there are like other reasons, of course, that I like to learn about new places. I'm curious to meet people in their own environment and to learn something from them, but also at the same time to share my experience. So it's kind of like let's call it cultural exchange or something, but I like to share and I like to learn, and I believe that I don't know, there is that you can learn a lot, not only about the world but also about yourself when you travel and when you go around and like try to adapt with in different cultures and environments and stuff. And yeah.
So what made you go east, actually, rather than, a lot of people think of leaving Serbia is to go to, you know, the West and, you know, make some money and all this stuff. What
people have different motivation, I guess. Like they're motivated by money or something, I guess. That's their main reason, you know. Like,
so what
I
was
mean,
your
like,
motivation?
My motivation was, I really like, I was always
curious about these cultures in the East and about their history, about their cultures. I was reading a lot before I went there, and like I'm really interested in that kind of world over there, because this world is very different than the world we know and the world that we travel to, like, which is West. I mean, we are kind of I don't know, let's say mentally maybe like connected to the Western cultures or something, I mean, like, or we are trying to do or something. So I was really interested in discovering and adapting into this different lifestyle, and to see how it's over there, and I don't know, I guess that's my main reason. And I and Asia is very big, like, I mean, it's I wanted to discover like as many places as possible over there, and yeah.
So you started your journey hitchhiking from here, right?
If we talk about 5 years ago, then yes.
Yeah. Like, so you were leaving here. You were not knowing that you were going on a trip, but did you ever think it would turn into what it did with you living in another country?
I was not really expecting that this journey will last so long, but. I would say that, like, once you're in Asia, like, you feel pretty much comfortable with everything over there. Like, life is, I think, much easier. Well, not easier, but, like, how to say, like, more comfortable or something. You don't really feel pressure in Asia. That's my, how to say, that's my observation or something. I think that people in general, they're, I got a feeling that they're, I don't know, a bit nicer than Europeans, maybe, from, I don't know, some, in some cases, I mean, not in all, but yeah. And especially in Southeast Asia, they're not you know, they're kind of calm, and they're not really how to say, they're not, they tend not to create conflicts, like, or argue with other people and stuff. And I believe that I learned to be more patient over there, like, than, I don't know, than I used to be, I guess. I don't know. I mean,
okay, so you went through first Turkey, and then where did the journey go from there?
So I started actually hitchhiking in April 2012. I reached Turkey by hitchhiking through Bulgaria, and then I went to North Iraq.
Just take us, like, country by country in the impressions. Mm-hmm. Like, if you can tell us in, like, you know, 20 seconds, half a minute, 1 minute of each country that you passed through, and what your cultural impressions were, how the slide from Serbia to Asia occurs.
Well, it was very interesting to go by land, because, you know, I don't know, like, one culture, you know, starts fading out and other cultures starts fading in. I don't know if it makes sense, but yeah.
It makes perfect sense, yeah.
I don't really know how to describe that, but I could feel, you know, like, that each culture is kind of connected to the previous, you know, from country to country, that there are, like, there are a lot of connections, you know, between countries, and it's... people are very similar, but they do like creating some differences and some barriers and stuff. And I think we have here in the Balkans this, how is it called, like, national identity crisis. I mean, it's you know, it's very present here, but it's pretty much everywhere in the world, just in just not as much as here, I think. But you know, everywhere I've been, like, you know, I don't know how to say, but people are very similar to each other, but then they like to create these differences, because everybody is proud on their own history, on their own way of life, of their own culture, and yeah, there's probably more things to say, but I might not be concentrated or something. I don't
okay,
know.
So northern Iraq. Like, I'm guessing that was Kurdistan.
Yeah, that's like Kurdistan, like which functions like a country inside a country. They have like their own how to say, their own way, their own their culture. Their, I mean, it. how to say it, it functions like in an independent way. Like you can pretty much go there without visa or something, while you cannot really continue onwards, like in further into Iraq, because there are checkpoints, which are sort of like border, like but they're not actually border, like so it's yeah, I don't know.
And from there you went to Iran.
Yeah, I was in Kurdistan, or let's call it Iraq, for a couple of days, and from there, like, I continued hitchhiking into Iran.
Okay, so I know that, yeah, both cultures sort of speak an Indo-European language, mm-hmm. and both cultures are sort of like somehow in the Islamic sphere. Mm-hmm. Of the world, yeah. But one of them is more pro-Western and the other is less so. Is that true?
You mean on Turkey, right?
No, like Kurdistan, like Kurds mm-hmm. in Iraq are known yeah. for being like, you know, America's people there or something.
Sort of, yeah. I mean, like...
And then you cross over into Iran. And what's the defining moment when you go across the border? What do you notice?
When I crossed... Well, actually... let me remember. The border was actually really easy to cross, as I remember. Like, you know, there were not really that big queues. Just they didn't allow us going with the same guy who drove us there. Like, I mean, we had to go by walking and then go into his truck. But the first thing in Iran, like, I mean, first I didn't really feel that much difference because I entered in a Kurdish part of Iran, you know. And even though there is a border between these two countries, the culture is the same, you know, because...
So maybe like going from sides, Serbia to Bosnia, Serbian part of Bosnia.
Pretty much.
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that, okay. Yeah. So it was pretty much similar cultures and stuff. And the further we went, the more differences were there. But like Iran as a country is kind of more strict, I think, in a, how to say, in a... In a way of controlling people or something.
Religious and moral sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of, yeah. But,
Did you get the sense that there were lots of people in Iran who were very interested in hearing about different cultures and stuff?
Absolutely.
Like that?
Absolutely. Yeah. I found people in Iran very very intelligent and very curious. I think, I mean, like they have like very long history and... things to be proud of, but yeah, it's like as countries are different in their own way, like, you know, there is there are kind of limits, you know, there are things that they cannot do and then they can do, but like I mean, in general, like I really had a good good time in Iran, especially because of people's hospitality, and not only hospitality but also about their curiosity, about their education. I think not only I don't talk about the school or university, but like awareness about the world. They are really. I got a feeling they're really open-minded, even more than some Europeans actually. Like when it comes to, you know, the discussions about everything and stuff.
It sounds a little bit like Serbia to me. In Maybe. Comparison to other European countries. So, from Iran, where did you go?
Once I was in Iran, like actually, I was thinking to go to China. Actually, I was planning to go to China from Iran to fly. But then, like once I was there, I decided to explore the idea of going by land. You know, going over land all the way to China,
which sounded impossible to everyone you knew before that. Or
kind of actually before Iran, I applied for a visa for Pakistan because my original idea was to go to Pakistan. Unfortunately for us Serbians, it's possible, but then like. We need to wait for 2 to 3 months for a possible approval or disapproval. But, you know, at that time, I didn't really have that much time to wait. So by the time I got approval from Pakistan, I was already in Iran. And then I couldn't really apply for Pakistan visa over there because it's out of my country. So I decided to go to Embassy of Afghanistan, although I would... you know, it was not even in my mind like that I should go to Afghanistan. But then like, I did some research and stuff, and And I was curious, you know, I just saw Embassy of Afghanistan over there with their flag, and then I was really curious to check out, like, what do I need for visa? Although I was, you know, I didn't really believe that I'll get visa, you know, in easy way. So I stepped into the Embassy of Afghanistan, and they were like, it seemed like, you know, it reminded me on prison or something, because there are like, you know, so many Afghan refugees in Iran, and then like, you know, the embassy was full of people, you know, asking for something and like, you know, being loud and stuff. So I think I was pretty much the only foreigner over there. You know? And then people didn't realize actually that I was a foreigner, because I have this look that, I don't know, can...
Mediterranean, can pass, South, yeah, European. Like,
can pass, okay, in many countries, you know. I can pass as a local, I guess, or something. And so I walked inside the embassy, and once they realized that I'm a foreigner, they called the consul, you know, and I asked him, like, what are requirements for visa and stuff, and he told me, where do you plan to go? I said, like, well I am probably Herat and Kabul. I said, like, oh, Herat is my hometown, like, it would be very nice.
Grate.
So I just asked him, what do I need, and he told me that I need approval from my own embassy, that they let me go, you know. And I just need to pay 40 euros and stuff, and in some bank. And he told me, just bring me this and I'll give you a visa next day. So I went to my embassy and I said that I want to go to Afghanistan. I was like, you're going where?
Sto?
I was like, what?
Yeah.
Said, oh yeah, don't worry. I'll be going like to Herat and North Afghanistan, and I'll fly. I'll not go to dangerous places and stuff. And you know, after talking to them, and they understood, and then like after paying like some 30 euros for one stamp, I got approval from Serbian embassy. You know, everything you need to, you know, every document you need, like you pay like $30-$40 for a stamp and signature. Yeah.
Bam.
So.
And then you're off. Okay, we're gonna take a really short break, and after this really short break, you're gonna tell us how it was being you in Afghanistan.
All right.
Hey folks, it's Eric from Belgrade Beat, and I just wanted to let you know that we are looking for volunteers to help with Belgrade Beat, which until now is not for profit, to do the technical side of things, you know, do a little shooting, a little editing. So if you're interested, just write a message to us on YouTube, or you can send me an email. My email address is eric@eriktechkorusa, Eric, E-R-I-K, @erik.rs. So, thanks. Now back to the interview with Nenad.
Okay, welcome back. So basically on the story, this was the point where you got your visa for Afghanistan from your friend that you made, and the Serbs who somehow approved you to go into this country. So what were you thinking? You know, at this point, were the Americans still active there in the country, or?
I think so, yeah. Well,
didn't matter, right?
It was alright. You know, I read that Herat and kind of north of Afghanistan was safe, especially like Mazar-e-Sharif.
And so did you tell your parents? Did you write back to Serbia, I'm going to Afghanistan?
Yeah, it was bye. Well, yeah, it's like, you know, I needed to persuade them that that everything is fine, you know, that that
but you didn't know that, right?
That we got like bad media coverage, you know, during 90s and stuff, and that about Afghanistan is also getting a bit exaggerated, you know. So
yeah.
So I told them that which might be actually true, you know, like it's not as bad, like, you know, as media shows it, you know. It's it's actually like there are some really really safe places, you know. That like Herat is really safe, and the thing was, like, you know, how to continue by land, like further. Like the thing is that roads are not safe. You know, many cities are safe, but you know, there have been like you know, cases that people get kidnapped, people get killed, people get robbed.
Okay, so you cross this border knowing all of this. And
across the border,
how does it feel?
To cross the border? Well, yeah, I was the only one crossing the border, you know, like there was nobody, you know. they actually closed the border for lunchtime, which is like 3 hours because there is nobody there, you know, and I just waited, like, you know, so they opened the border. And, you know, I just walked in, you know, as simple as that. It's like I just walked into Afghanistan.
And then where did you go? Where did you have like a contact there that you were?
I went to Herat because Herat is the first city like from the border. It's not far from there. And I got a couchsurfing host. Like, yeah, by the way, like I've been using couchsurfing, you know, hospitality.
Yeah, that's how I met you. Yeah. First place I stayed with you, Nish. Yeah, so I mean that's the best
and,
website for.
Yeah, it's like hospitality exchange websites that helps you like get in touch with local communities and stay with local and learn a lot and stuff. So I've been using it for 9 years. So naturally, like I've been using it in Afghanistan. So I had a
of course.
Yeah, I mean like there are hosts everywhere except maybe North Korea because there is no internet. But yeah, so. My host, it was a very nice guy, and then I met, he drove me around, and then like, and from him I found out that it's kind of dangerous going by land anywhere, pretty much, because like central roads had some problems before, like people get kidnapped. North road used to be okay, but. You know, meanwhile, while I went there, like it became dangerous again. And South Road is the most dangerous, the road that is going through Kandahar. So I had to prepare, you know, what to do. And I was hitchhiking until that point. And, you know, I decided to take a public bus to Kabul, although it was still dangerous, you know, because... if somebody would know, like that, there is a foreigner in a bus. You know, there would be like chance that I get kidnapped.
Yeah,
and
they could do.
I don't think that my country would pay something for me. So, I mean, like it's what came to my mind. So before taking that bus, I tried to hitchhike a helicopter. So I went to American Embassy actually to ask them to if they have some helicopter or something, and told me that they're not taxi service. So, anecdote.
Well, hey guys,
do you have a helicopter?
Do you have?
Yeah. So I decided to go to. To take a bus.
If it, yeah.
By pretending that I am a local guy because I had advantage. I grew my mustache and my beard and I was more hairy than I am now. And people told me that I look like one of them. You know, like people are talking to me there, like in their own language and stuff. And I thought, okay, like that can be good. Like, you know, so I just bought. I haven't bought. My host actually he gave me local clothes, so I looked exactly like a local. And you know, the only thing was language. So I decided to pretend that I'm deaf and mute. And you know, everybody was thinking that I'm local. You know, I was like acting dumb and deaf and mute and stuff. And it worked. It worked perfectly. So he just came, you know, I put my backpack into the sack, like local people are doing or something, and he just came with me to the bus station, and he told the bus driver that I'm his deaf cousin Morteza, or something like that, and so they take care of me, and everything went smooth. We went to the South Road, which is the most dangerous, but then, like, you know, there are dangers from landmines, there are dangers from, how to say, Talibans, then road bandits who just come and, like, rob you and stuff. And that's it. So, like, pretty much, like with this road bandits, I could just gamble, but they're not so common over there. You know, with Talibans, it will be okay, I guess, because they would think that I'm local, I guess. And with the mines, you know, like just 3 days before my trip, some mine exploded on the road. So I was thinking that, you know, some bus got blown. Like, so they told me that, like, you know, after this thing happened, like, then the road gets more security. So I think my chances were quite good. So I was fine. I mean, not that I would do this again ever. But
it's a story, you know, though. You
but,
survived.
It was, yeah. It was experience. What I didn't know is that actually that we will actually go to Kandahar. So we were in Kandahar on the middle of the road. You know, I didn't realize. I was thinking just that we will go through. But then, like, we just stopped there. Like, you know, like, I just saw that we are around and stuff. Oops. But it was fine. And after, I think, 16 or 17 hours of that journey, like, I arrived, and yeah, it was nice. And like, and people in the bus, they were actually, I think they were feeling sorry for me because I was like deaf and dumb, and then they were like offering me to eat and stuff, and it, you know, everything was fine. So once I arrived in Kabul, like, my host, actually my couchsurfing host, he couldn't really believe that what I did, because not even many locals do the same. But I was fine, and from that moment, you know, like, everything was pretty much safe, because that road was the only thing I think considered as dangerous. But, like, you know, in Kabul is not, it's not so bad. I mean, as long as you keep low profile, and I mean, not so low, but it's I mean, there are still like many foreigners and stuff, and they're like it is kind of multicultural, I think. And it's more liberal than like the rest of Afghanistan. And I mean, yeah, some things happen from time to time, but as long as you avoid like crowded places, it's okay, I think.
By the way, my parents went to Afghanistan on their honeymoon in 1976.
Really?
Before the Soviets came.
Hmm.
And
it's a beautiful country, actually. Like, it's and people are nice, I think. Like, people are very kind, despite all these problems and issues they have. I mean, of course, they don't trust people so easy, but once they do, like, they like to show their hospitality. In general, the whole Central Asia, like Iran, Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, and, like, people are really, really hospitable. And they do have problems and stuff, but I got a feeling that, you know, like, when I was in Afghanistan, I was there like for 3 weeks, and, you know, it felt like perfectly safe country, you know, like, you get this feeling, you know, like, that it's a safe country until something happens. And I guess people got used to all these problems, and I mean, what can they do? I mean, they still have their life to live, so they need to, I guess, keep positive or something. I mean, so yeah, once I arrived in Kabul, I call it my summer vacation in Kabul, because I stayed there like 7 days. And I had a nice host. I slept in a TV station. He worked there in a TV station, and it was nice. And after that, I just continued hitchhiking, like, up north. So yeah, people were yeah, of course, they couldn't believe that I was hitchhiking in Afghanistan, but then they were still, you know, happy to give me a ride.
How many cars, and, like, okay, so how long would you have to wait in Afghanistan to get picked up?
Well, not so long. I went to some junction, and then people actually stopped, and then, like, you know, they drove me to, you know, first car drove me to some checkpoint, because I asked them, okay, it would be fine if I am at the checkpoint, then, like, people can slow down, like, and then maybe police can help. So at the checkpoint, of course, they couldn't believe that there is a crazy foreigner hitchhiking.
Yeah.
So I, they just went through my things like quickly, and they just saw my hard drives, thinking that it's a bomb or something. But then they realized, of course, it's not. And some truck came. So I just jumped in a truck, and although they were confused, they let me in with that truck, and then I went further, like, for a few hours until the truck stopped, because trucks were not allowed going further, like, after 6 p.m. So I was pretty much in the middle of the road, which is kind of empty road to Mazar-e-Sharif, And I hitched, and then the bus stopped, offering me a free ride. And they drove me all the way up. The bus had like, I don't know, 10 passengers and a lot of papers and stuff. And then, you know, in the middle of the night, I woke up. You know, I was sleeping and I realized there is nobody and there are no passengers. And I was alone in a bus and I was thinking maybe we are getting kidnapped or something. But we weren't. So they were just sleeping. And in the morning, like, they just told me that I need to help them unload the papers. And that was it. And once I was in Mazar-i-Sharif, I was pretty much almost the end of my trip. I just continued further up north, where I was actually detained and arrested under suspicion of being a terrorist, because I looked like
what?
One.
Yeah. By who?
By Afghan police.
Okay, but which, I know it's many tribes there, which?
I guess local, some local Pashtun, something, something. I don't really know.
Okay.
But then, like, you know, I was suspicious, I guess, because of my look. I was like very, like, I would be scared of myself if I see myself.
Yeah.
You know, and yeah, it was actually fine. Like, I just waited one day because it was Friday, so they were like, they had day off, and then the next day they came to interrogate me, and you know, they. You know, in this country, you know, it's kind of difficult to, how to say,
distinguish. Did they speak English or something?
To distinguish tourists from terrorists. They, yeah, especially when they're not tourists. They spoke Russian, actually, in the north. Some of them, they spoke English, but, yeah, they spoke Russian because they... They had this this war with Russia like a long time ago. So many of them, yeah, in the north, they can, the older people.
It was an influence on their borders,
yeah.
Basically.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, so they understand Russian, and then like the man who interrogated me told me that he was fighting Russians like a long time ago, and once I crossed into Tajikistan, the other man who gave me a ride, he told me that he fought Afghans and stuff. So yeah, it was quite interesting.
So they let you out after how many hours of interrogation?
It was maybe like 1 or 2 hours or something. They were actually very kind, and then they felt sorry. Yeah. They explained to me that they have to do that, which, I mean, of course, I don't blame them.
You're in a room. Did they feed you? Did they give you water?
Yeah, they fed me. They gave me water. It was nice. It was almost like a hotel room. just a TV was black and white, you know.
And just the thoughts in your head are like, what the fuck?
Not really, you know.
No, you were used to everything at this point.
I was kind of, yeah, I was getting used to everything.
It's so like the Zen mentality.
Yeah, it's quite okay. I mean, I understood. And I, you know, like, once you go in a world, everywhere, actually, with a positive feeling, then I believe that positive things will happen to you. And, you know, I never really had any big problems, or at least I didn't feel like I'm having problems. I might had some problems, you know, but not in my head.
So
I mean, not in, you know, like, my mind was cool. So I was like, Yeah, and then they gave me, you know, after interrogation, they gave me candies, they gave me some traditional Afghan coat as a present, and, you know, it was very nice, actually.
Okay, folks, we're going to take another short, really short break, and we will be back, and we'll hear about China and Indonesia, and what it's like to live in those countries. Right back with you. Okay, so we're back, and from Afghanistan, from...
So, from Afghanistan, I continued onwards to Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and finally China. But, yeah, I think people would be interested, like, in a way, like, how I got visas, because, like, these visas, you know, I need visas for all the countries, almost all the countries, like, I go to Asia. So, basically, yeah, what I want to say, like, it's... that you getting all these visas, you can do it in like one country before or two countries before. You just prepare a lot of papers, do copy paste that you have money, that you have status, that you know what you're doing, you have flight tickets. I mean, not real tickets, but you know, you just do bookings and stuff, and you need to print like everything to look presentable, and then like you know, once you have like everything in order, like it's not really difficult getting visa to anywhere.
British. And you go, and they've never met somebody from Serbia before, probably never even heard of the country, maybe, who knows? But
pretty much, yeah. There are cases,
like,
yeah.
Oh, looks like a nice guy. Here we go, boom.
Yeah, kind
right?
of. Yeah, not so bad. Yeah. The big irony, like about my trip to Tajikistan, is that you know after nothing happened in Afghanistan for like 3 weeks, like the first day in Tajikistan, I got a problem, and it was pretty much I think the only problem that I had on my journeys.
So
and
problem. Okay, what does
problem? Well,
no. Okay,
say,
so you're doing what? Just walking down the street or whatever?
I was just walking down the street, you know. It was my first day in Tajikistan, so I was like...
You're in the capital or...?
I was in the capital, Dushanbe, you know. I got a ride to Dushanbe, and like I was with my backpack. Like,
and what does this place look like, the vibe there?
Dushanbe it looks actually like a post-apocalyptic city, you know, which is the country is actually poor, but then like they like to show off, and there are like many new buildings, like they're kind of statues of gold, and there
sounds
pictures,
like Macedonia,
maybe, yeah. There are like pictures of president like everywhere, like, you know, everywhere you go, like there is a president in a he's in a, you know, eating bread, he's running with people, he's like in a, you know, it's yeah, I mean, yeah, it's interesting actually. He's in a flowers field of flowers and stuff, and you know, it was really interesting, like, you know, very different than other places, like, you know, I mean, still there are some vibes from like a Soviet Union, you know, from you know, like remainings of Soviet Union and stuff, but it felt like a nice place, except that Tajikistan is one of the most corrupted countries in the world. You know, they asked me for $1 to put me a stamp on the border. I didn't give them, of course. Like every time, like I was in some new place, some policemen would stop and they would ask, like, you know, a bribe from people. You know, like people would always pay cups, and you know, it didn't really give me a feeling of security, like high security or something. But it still felt like, you know, like an okay country. I mean, like at least for tourists or something. And anyway, I was walking down the street, and a guy came like out of nowhere, like showing me his badge and speaking to me in Russian. I mean, I can speak Russian, so I continued speaking to him. I don't know if it was like a good idea or stuff, but you know, at the time, like, you know, I was thinking like, okay, he's a cop, maybe I should just cooperate or something and stuff. And anyway, he started asking me questions, blah blah, well, who are you, where do you come from, like where have you been, blah blah blah. He acted suspicious, although he looked a bit strange. I was not, even now, I'm not sure if he was a real cop or not, you know. But, you know, in a country like this, you don't really have idea. And then he went through my things from the back, and, you know, everything was all right. But then, like, you know, after some time, he asked me to open my bag again. And then he found out something that I didn't know that I have, like, apparently, like, while I was busy with like answering his questions and stuff, the other guy that he was with, he probably planted it in my bag, and he said like, oh, what is this, it's a heroin or something, you know. And I don't really know how heroin looks like, so I don't have idea. Actually, I think it's white or something, I don't know, but I couldn't tell if it was like a real heroin or if it was like a dust or whatever, you know. But you know, I was kind of trapped, and I didn't really know what to do. So, you know, he started blackmailing me that I could get in, you know, I could get in prison for like 10 years or something, you know, if I don't collaborate.
Shit.
And blah 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 stuff. So, you know, like in this kind of situation, you know, I don't know what to do. And he wanted $600 or $700 or more, like I think he wanted much more, like as a bribe. But then I told him, like, listen man, like I'm from Serbia, like I don't have this money, like I, you know, just, he was going through my things, and the only thing he found is like $100. So I said, like, you know, besides that, I have nothing else, although I had something hidden, so I was sure that he will not find it. And I had a card where I didn't really have that much money or something. But then, like, you know, eventually, you know, after a long time of negotiation, he was satisfied with this $100, and that was my price for freedom.
Did you stay positive during that whole experience?
No, of course, it's experience. You know, I don't think it's a negative experience. You learn something from each experience. You know, I mean, like, when you travel, like, you know, there are things that happen, and, you know, you're just experiencing the world, and you just learn how the world works, like, what you should do, like, you learn on your mistakes sometimes. I mean, it's better to learn on somebody else's mistakes, of course, and to be prepared when you go to some country. Like for example, when I went to Afghanistan, you know, I didn't just go, like, not knowing where I'm going, but I read, you know, I got informed, like, you know, I talked to people, you know, I ask people, what should I do, what I shouldn't do, you know, what to avoid. You know, the more you talk to people, not only locals, but also the travelers, you connect to travel blogs. You know, I read, like, a lot about Afghanistan and also Tajikistan before I went there. So you just go prepared. But still, yeah, you know, even if you're prepared, like, you know, you should know, like, for example, like, I wouldn't suggest that you carry a lot of cash with you. I mean, like, yeah, things like this happen, like, you know, they will take everything you have. And although they don't really happen often, you know, it happened only once for, you know, I've been traveling maybe like 9 or 10 years. This kind of thing, like, you know, it happened only once that I get robbed. And, you know, it might happen, like, more times, but, you know, you should just be more prepared and stuff. And anyway, like, you know, it didn't ruin my experience, of course. I mean, like, it was experience, as I said. And I just continued traveling further. And I had a great experience through Tajikistan, through Kyrgyzstan, through Kazakhstan. People are really nice and really hospitable. And the places are really beautiful. You know, like, you're crossing Pamir, like, mountains. Where there is, like, you know, it was a bit difficult hitchhiking, though, in Tajikistan, because, you know, in places like this, there is like 1 or 2 cars per day. But, you know, you learn to be patient, you know. You just go and you wait, you know. If nobody comes today, they will come tomorrow, you know. What can you do? You just enjoy what you have. You know, in every place, in every country, there is something to enjoy.
And there's, you know, nice people everywhere as well.
Of course, absolutely, yeah. You just have to believe that there are nice people and they will come. They're there, like, you know. The energy you share is the energy you will get. That's my, you know, my way of thinking and stuff. And I got, like, you know, I had met, like, amazing people everywhere, and I had a great time, and I have absolutely enjoyed, like, every minute of my traveling or living somewhere. You know, I mean, that's my way how I live my life. You know, wherever I am, I just take the most positive things everywhere. And
you attract people who sort of resonate with that, who look at you and, you know, feel the same somehow, and you interact, and weird stuff happens sometimes, but
this life, I mean, it's normal, you know. It's,
All right, so you eventually ended up in China, right, on this trip?
Yeah, I did a lot of zigzags through Middle East and Central Asia, and eventually I ended up in China. So I hitchhiked from Xinjiang, which is the northwest of China on the border with Kazakhstan, all the way down to Hong Kong, where I got a visa at that time for longer stay. And then I continued all the way to the Far East, like, until I reached Hangzhou, which is at the Far East of China, like, just at the Yellow Sea. And the interesting anecdote, like, from this trip is that at some point, like, I actually ran out of money because my card got blocked. And I traveled almost without money for a couple of days. And it was fine, you know, like, I had a places to stay, like, not only through couchsurfing, but also through people I talked and who understood my situation. And you know, I was waiting actually for a couple of days for money to get processed from Serbia to China, because my card was blocked. And you know, people were helping me, like, people, I went to the bank, and then, like, I befriended a guy from the bank, so I was eating lunch and dinner in the bank, you know, like, next day I was hitchhiking to the next city, then in the next city I was sleeping in a hotel reception, you know, like, what can I say, like, every time you talk to people, you know, like, people can help you, like, you know, like any problem you got, you know, it's not really that that difficult, you know, like as long as you establish the right connection with people, you know, it's really not so difficult. So I mean, I could have stayed, like, you know, in that, it was in Guilin, you know, I could have stayed there and waited for, you know, things to happen, but I had my destination where I had to go. So, you know, even with money or without money, whatever, you know, I just know, I mean, like, I will make it. And hitchhiking in China is actually not so difficult. So you can just sometimes you can pass more than 1,000 kilometers per day. So it's fine.
And so you eventually settled down and got a job in China. So.
Yeah. At that time, and just when I ran out of money and my money was about to come, I signed a contract when I was there, and that money that I got, like, actually came later, came after I got some help from the school and stuff, you know, they usually help their new teachers. So I found a job, yeah, as an English teacher, as you might know, like, it's not so difficult finding a job in China, as long as your English is good and your self-esteem is positive. I think having self-esteem is more important than having a good English or something. You need to know how to advertise yourself, to present them that you're good and stuff. And, you know, it's not so difficult. Now finding a job in China, it's easy. But finding a good job, right, it takes a while. So it just depends what are your priorities. Like, you know.
Okay, so once you got a job, you have this place where you're living. What was the vibe of the city?
It was okay. I mean, I liked Hangzhou, but the problem is that I went working in a smaller place, and you know, usually I do prefer smaller cities for living, but not in China, because
yeah. Okay, so what's the culture there like, and where you were? I mean, what was your, like,
people were I don't know how to say, Chinese society is very different, and cultural differences are very big. It's not for everybody. You know, I met many people and they either like it or hate it or something, but I don't know, I was trying to get used to that and then to create some balance or something, and it was fine, but
did
it was
boring.
Did you
feel included in the society, or did you feel like you were just some foreigner?
I didn't feel like part of society at all. You know, if I would be like in a bigger city, like I was later on in life, it's much easier, because the bigger the city is, the bigger the chances are that you will meet more people, not only international people, but people with international way of thinking. If you go to smaller cities, people don't have this way of thinking. They're part of
I want to say almost tribal, but or like a local then. Whatever, they have their culture, and you're
they're a bit reserved, and you know, they have their culture, and they don't really try to open, like, they are kind of curious, but they're not so curious. How to say, like, they're many, especially in the smaller cities, like their interests are limited, and you know, in that way, like, the topics you can talk about, it's like, they're limited as well. And you know, I mean, there are very nice people and stuff, but after some time, I think, you know, life in the small cities in China can be boring. You know, like, I lived in Shaoxing, which is like, has like 4 million people. This is a small city in China, you know, like, for China, this is a small city. And after that, I changed. So I lived in an island where I thought it will be like nice because it's an island, but then, like, I think, you know, I was pretty much the only foreigner in that island, so it didn't really help, although I was curious. But you know, the thing is that I at that time I didn't plan staying in China for too long, so eventually I stayed there like I think 5 months working, or 5.5 months working, something like that, I think, in total. because I had a problem, and my problem was that my passport was getting full, so there was no time. I mean, I had to say there was no space in my passport, basically getting another visa. So I could just, you know, stay until, you know, certain time, and that's it. Later on, I left China, and then I had an idea to continue traveling. I actually wanted to travel, but the thing was that I had to go back home to get new passports, because from the whole Asia, it was not possible anywhere to get new Serbian passports. So, you know, I had to go back home.
And so you came back here, and that was the first time. How long did you stay? I mean, I remember I saw you then in 2013, but how long did you manage to stay here?
I stayed here like 3 or 4 months, something like that. I didn't stay here all the time. Yeah, I've been traveling a little bit. But yeah, I didn't actually come straight from China. I've been traveling after that. I wanted to go to Thailand, but then like I realized I could go to a few more countries. So I did go to a few more countries where I didn't need visa for. And eventually I came to Serbia. So I replaced my passport and I stayed for a couple of months. And then I went back to Asia.
So what was the thing with Indonesia? How did you end up there?
When I was traveling in Myanmar after China, I met a girl that she was Indonesian. So then like
Myanmar, okay, that's a country that's recently opened up to foreign influence or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, at that time when I was there, like it started opening. It was after China. It was like 2013. Like I went to Laos, Thailand, Myanmar. After Myanmar, like there was no space at all. Like, you know, before that I kind of made space. After that, after Myanmar, I didn't have space. So I flew to Singapore. From Singapore, I flew to Sri Lanka. From Sri Lanka, I flew to Lebanon. From Lebanon, I went to Cyprus, and from Cyprus, I took a boat to Turkey, and from Turkey, I went back home. So that journey lasted 14 months. And meanwhile, on that journey, like I met this girl in Myanmar, who turned out being my girlfriend, like now my ex-girlfriend. But yeah, at that time, like I, So when I came to Serbia, she came to visit me. So like then we did a journey like around Serbia, not only Serbia, but like I think 7, 8, 9 more countries. Yeah, around like. So I was not in Serbia all the time. And then I realized that I'll just move to Indonesia. So I bought a one-way ticket and moved to Indonesia. I didn't really plan to go there, but I was really curious about Indonesia. I mean, it's a very different country, like with different cultures. And and 300, I think more than 300 sort of nations and 300 different languages, actually. So it has a very, very interesting... history and culture and of course I was curious, but yeah.
And so does that compare to China? So you're going there and obviously like, you know, if people are from there, mm-hmm. everything here in Europe looks like Europe. Mm-hmm. And they might notice certain differences, but if you're going to Indonesia and you've been to China, everything in Asia might look like Asia or Eastern Asia, whatever it is. Asia. What were the differences that you noticed from China to Indonesia? I mean,
well, there are big differences, you know. Yeah. China is different with every place on a planet. It feels like different planet, actually, like China, you know.
Their culture is very specific.
It's very specific, yeah. And it's very different, like, and it takes a lot of time to get used to life in China, while in Southeast Asia life is very relaxed and very easy, you know, and everything feels like super easy. And, you know, getting friends is very easy. People are very positive, especially in Indonesia. People are very positive, very enthusiastic, very friendly, very talkative, very nosy. They want to know everything about everybody. And I like that thing, you know, like it felt like very positive environment, and I really, really enjoyed it. You know, some people find it overwhelming, you know, but, you know, I really liked it. The thing that I don't like is like big cities in Southeast Asia. They're very crazy and chaotic comparing to China. That China has like really well organized cities comparing to, you know, Southeast Asia. And Jakarta especially, I consider it as one of the worst places I've ever been. But I like it a lot. I think it's one of my favorite cities, I think. So,
yeah, folks, technical difficulties on the cameras here. All of them are shutting off, but we will have some way of continuing with only a moment's break. Anyways, go on. So, where did you live in Indonesia? And
I lived in Jakarta, which is people call it big durian, but I call it a cancer, because like the more you're there, the more it grows in you. Like it's like a, you know, it's a cancer, and it's a stinky, polluted, ugly capital city.
So but why did you live there?
It has a soul.
Why did you live there?
First, I moved because of my ex-girlfriend, and you know, I was curious. I wanted to give it a chance. You know, I didn't like it in the beginning, but then like later, I found my place there, and I really liked the people there and mentality in general. And as much as I didn't enjoy in one way, like, you know, I enjoyed it in another way. Eventually I found like I found many friends there, like, and I went to many places around, and it was a good base actually for exploring the places where I never been, and to discover something about the culture that I never known about, you know. And and so it was interesting, and what to say, like my life changed like once I bought a motorbike, because it was much easier to navigate around. And driving a motorbike in Jakarta is like being inside a video game, you know, like that you're you know, it's a big chaos, like, you know, if you look like some videos or something, or if a person, like, you know, if a pedestrian looks like over there, they would think that they could never drive. But once you start driving, it's actually there is a perfect harmony in all this chaos, you know, like, because everything works well, you know, there are not many crashes or I don't know.
Yeah, well, here in Belgrade, actually, I see a lot of them. And what I find is it's often there's somebody in Belgrade who's following the rules by the book, and there's someone in Belgrade who's just going with it, and those people crash into each other.
Yeah.
And they jump out of the car, you know, like, oh, didn't you see me? Oh, you weren't following the rules, you know, like, but there, it's harmony, right?
Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, the thing works well, because, like, you know, there are many cars and motorbikes and this kind of tricycles or whatever, and like trucks and everything, you know, is everywhere. You know, they don't have metro, but they have this kind of chaos. But the things work because like people kind of respect the person in front, and they always brake, you know, if he brakes or something. You know, they don't have feeling like being like in, you know, in this lane or the other lane. But, you know, somehow everything works, you know. And you know, the funny thing is that they don't really know, like they don't have a sense how to park the car, but there is always somebody, you know, to navigate them, like, you know, say left, right, and then they take something little, like some maybe 20 cents of a dollar or 10 cents of a dollar and stuff.
Really? So it's monetized. Everything is
pretty much, you know. Okay. The this is kind of a good thing comparing to many other Southeast Asian countries where you have a lot of beggars. You know, in Indonesia you don't have that many, but then like they kind of find some work that they can do, like, you know, they kind of take care of your motorbike or help you like unpark your car, you know, like these kind of people are everywhere, like they're doing nothing, but then they kind of help you, you like, you know, to unpark your car and stuff, and then like they kind of earn something at least and stuff. So what I want to say about Jakarta. Jakarta is a very, how to say, very chaotic city, like many other Southeast Asian cities. Urban planning is very bad, I think. Like, it's, you know, it's very difficult to be pedestrian in this city. There are big traffic jams that the whole population is complaining about. But you know, like I learned the language in these traffic jams. You know, it's because you know I didn't know what to do. Like you know, for 2 hours, 3 hours, getting stuck in a traffic jam. So I just talk to people, and then like you know, everybody wants to talk to me, and then I want to talk to them, and then like I was just bringing my notebook, and I learned the language like in 3 months or 4 months or something.
Yeah,
it's very easy.
I heard that language is easy, actually. Yeah,
it is easy. Yeah, you know, and it has some kind of similar similar words. Actually, same words in Serbian, but they mean different thing.
Like what?
Like for example, you know how to say we are young.
Mm-hmm.
Tita muda. Yeah. So that's you know.
Something with the balls is.
Yeah.
Okay.
And or yeah, there are many of these kind of, you know.
Okay.
Funny. Yeah. So it's it makes it easy like to learn it.
Okay, so you're back here in Serbia.
Yeah.
So what, you got off the plane a couple of days ago?
Yeah.
How did it feel when you got back? Was this feeling of, because, you know, like, if I go back to Canada, I feel this, like, sudden wave of, oh, way too familiar, and...
Yeah, it is familiar. Just now, like, you know, everything is so different, because I see it from one different point of view, you know. How to say, I mean, like, I'm glad that I'm back and stuff, but you know, I mean, I don't
know. You changed so much, and here didn't change enough, right? Is that the feeling?
Maybe it can be described like that. Or I can say that now I observe some other things that I didn't observe before. I know,
for example,
things that
people are tall.
People are tall. You know, after you come from Asia, you know, it's like how to say, like, maybe things changed, maybe I changed or something, but yeah, maybe it's not as smooth as it was in Asia. I think that the life is not so smooth or something, but I don't really know how to explain. Maybe I need to think about it. I cannot really even express it by words, you know. You know, I just have these feelings that,
like, people have expectations and they're not being met. Like, there's expectations about life which are, I don't know, tell me about Serbia from this perspective now.
I don't know, I think people are, well, it didn't change much actually, like, when I went there, like, but yeah, what can I say? I mean, people in Serbia complain, like, you know, in daily basis, which is like, I think it started being like one of the landmarks of Serbia. Even like many of my foreign friends noticed it. I mean, okay, it's normal to complain, but I think that people do have a good life, but they just don't realize that their life is good. And I think, yeah, we see like some, you know, some positive, we do some positive things, and we know how to have a positive things, because, like, you know, we are very friendly people, and we have many friends, you know, and people really have like this kind of respect towards the friends that many people in other places, they don't, like, especially in China or South Korea. You know, South Korea didn't really leave very positive
impression
on me, you know, because I felt that people are not really happy, you know. I mean,
okay,
or satisfied.
But so, Serbia, like,
I think people have good life. They might not be satisfied, but they're
not grateful for it. Are they grateful for it here?
I don't think so. I don't know. I mean, like, you know, we will always blame somebody else for our own you know, misfortune or something like that. And you know, I don't know. I mean, like, I believe that everybody can change their own life if they really want to. You know, if there is a will, there is a way, I guess. If, you know, if there is something that you're unhappy about, like, you can change, or at least you can trade it for something else. I think there is always, from my own life, there is always something to be happy about. I mean, you know, there are always positive things in life. And I don't know, even if you're like in China or Indonesia or wherever, or America or something, or in Serbia, you can always find good things, I think, to enjoy. And then maybe people don't really appreciate this. I don't know. I guess. I don't know. I might be wrong, but it's just, I think, my way of seeing things.
Looking back, if you could go back and tell yourself in 2012 or when you left, if you could tell yourself something, give some advice to the person who was going on that journey, what would you say? If you were to be able to go back in time and tell yourself before you go on that journey, give some advice, what would you say?
To myself?
Yeah. Looking back on all of that.
I don't know. What would I say to myself? Take care, Nenad. I don't know.
So you feel like the journey went exactly as it was meant to?
I think so. Yeah. There is nothing that I would change. You know.
Okay.
I'm really happy that I did it.
Okay. So it's like other side of it. There's somebody who's listening to this right now, in Serbia.
Mm.
And they listen to your adventure and the possibilities that you opened yourself up to in life. And they're thinking of doing this. And they're living, let's say there's some 25-year-old, you know, in Novi Belgrad, and he's lived his life and whatever, you know, and he's knows he's ready for something next, and he hears your story, he says, that sounds interesting. What do you tell him to make him sort of just take the plunge and go into the world?
Well, I just take it, just get the courage to do the first step, because like once you do the first step, then everything is easy, you know, like you just need to start from somewhere, you know, doing something. Just go from here to wherever, to Bulgaria, you know, and just don't stay in Sofia, just continue further. And then once you go further, you know, you can always go like one more step. And it's not so difficult, you know, like, even if you don't have that much money, like you can think about it, and you can find alternative solution. You know, you can hitchhike if you want to save for transport. You can couch surf if you want to save on accommodation, or like you can always find people to help you. You just need to open to the world, and then the world will help you. You know, like that. It's like it's not so difficult. I mean. You know, you might need a little bit of money, but then like I think that you always you always can save something, because like you always need to give up something to get something else. You know, the way I saved, it's like that I didn't spend that much money, like, you know, when I was working or something. I saved something on the side. And, you know, if I, instead of going to some vacation, like many Serbians go, you know, like now when I came back from Thailand, like I met Serbians, like they came with 70 kilos of things, like spending probably like $2,000 or something for 10 days. You know, that's how many Serbian people travel. They save, then they go to Greece or Turkey or whatever, you know, and they spend a lot, you know. But you can do like a lot more, like with the same amount of money, you know, you just go, like, you know, little by little, and then like you get used to that, you know, you get, it becomes your routine. It's not really difficult. You can just, you know, you just go further and further, and then, like, you know, even though I travel alone, I'm not alone. I mean, I meet people everywhere I go.
Everywhere, yeah, of course.
And, you know, people, you know, I get, like, into very interesting conversation with people. You know, I never feel lonely or something, you know. And it's really interesting for me, you know, and it's very easy, very simple, you know, the same way, like, that people get, like, you know, get used to a routine of living daily life, waking up at 7, going to work and stuff, you know, it's, for me, you know, it's like a perfectly normal thing, like, you know, I just wake up in, you know, in Cambodia, then I go hitchhiking, then in the evening I'm in Thailand, you know, it's like, you know, it's just the way, you know, how you travel, how you live your life. And it's, you know, it's simple. You just go to the road, you find a car, you talk a lot with people, time passes, like, pop, you're already in another country, in another city, you know. You know, after traveling for so long, you know, I might not see the problem, but I think people's problem is getting out of this comfort zone, you know, and doing something that is not expected from them to do.
And so what's next for you?
I don't know. I will see.
Does this success mean for you, actually? What does...
Success?
Are you trying to build something in your life, or are you just trying to experience every day in the most sincere possible way?
I think I'm trying both. I'm planning maybe to use my experiences to... it would be nice, actually, to be an example for some people who can change something. And one day, if I find a time or something, I might... I don't know. I mean, I did write something, and I might write a bit more or something. So, success is well. I don't know if I can. For me, success is difficult to say. Like maybe to. I like learning, and I like sharing experience, and I'm really happy if I can make somebody change something, like in their life. If in any way, like I can help, you know, if I can motivate somebody to do something different that can make their life like more interesting or something, or you know, because people I met, many people I met, not only in Serbia, everywhere in the world, they prefer, you know, finding excuses than finding solutions for something, and I don't know. It would be nice to, you know, to help at least like a person or two, like with a solution or something. I don't really know, but I. Yeah. There are probably things I want to say, but I cannot remember. I don't know.
Well, thanks for describing everything about your journey and the whole...
Yeah, it's one small part, but...
Yeah, no, it's a small part, but yeah, I mean, but, I think just to share the story of the world of possibility you discovered going east from here, whereas everybody else always thinks of going the other direction. But, you know, like here on Belgrade Beat, I really want to bring people other perspectives of the world and hope... And I hope that somehow these filter into this local community in Serbia so that people go, but they also come back here to make this a better place.
And yeah, I like to believe that this can become like a better country for living. And I am actually sad that many young people are just following money and going somewhere and it being like their main.
But you followed the soul, man. You followed.
Yeah, maybe I believe like you know, if you follow the soul, like you can find the way to do something. Like,
So thanks for that, and I think you're an inspiration to a lot of us.
I'm
who.
Glad if I can be. I don't know.
So thanks for that, and best of luck for the future.
Yeah. Thank you.
And that's it. This is Belgrade Beat, and we are saying goodbye.